Brannick.
Morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court, I'm Steve Brannick of Brannick and Humphreys, here representing Dr. Kondapalli, who brought this derivative action on behalf of the corporate plaintiff here. If I may, I'd like to divide my time 10 and 10 because I'll be responding to the cross appeal as
all
well
right.
as presenting my rebuttal. Both sides appealed in this case. Obviously, Dr. Kondapalli is satisfied with the liability award. Our appeal concerns the damages and several legal errors that the trial judge made in connection with calculating the damages. And there are 2 points that I wanted to discuss today. The first was the point relating to the accounts receivable and the obligation of SSI to collect those accounts receivables. And then the second was to discuss a little bit about how damages should be calculated in the derivative context. Turning first to the accounts receivable claim, one of SSI's primary responsibilities was to collect the bills. In this situation, that's actually not a very complicated project because all of your payors, or virtually all your payors, are very solvent. You're sending bills to the government because of Medicare. You're sending bills to very solvent insurance companies. So you're not chasing around debtors. What you need to do is send the bills in correctly. You've got to dot your I's. You've got to cross your T's. You've got to fill out the forms correctly. And SSI did not. In fact, the trial judge said they did that very poorly and that they left readily collectible funds on the table because of numerous errors. So the fact of damages is absolutely clear here. Now, under Florida law, once you prove that you have suffered damages, some uncertainty in the actual amount of damages doesn't prevent you from recovering. And it makes perfect sense. The defendant who's put the plaintiff in that position shouldn't be able to just sit back and take pot shots at the damages and complain that the damages are too uncertain, because obviously no one can ever prove with absolute certainty what would happen in the future or what would have happened in the past had the collections been done the right way. So what you have to do, according to the Supreme Court in the venerable case of Twyman v. Roll, is to prove a reasonable benchmark or yardstick for the proof of the damages. And there were three very good yardsticks here. One was we had an expert that had 9.5 years experience in the Sarasota marketplace, knew how collections should be done, and testified based on her experience that the collections fell well short. They should have been 98% to 99% of the accounts receivable, and they were actually down about 83%.
But isn't her credibility subject to the discretion of the trial judge to determine? Her testimony had some problems with it. There were some errors. She was substantially, cross-examined and impeached. And while she had some practical experience, she didn't have a whole lot of paper behind her name. And she made some mistakes. And in the trial court, free to accept or reject some or all of her testimony?
Well, she made a mistake in terms of
calculating. As the finder of fact, of course.
Absolutely. But the trial judge also has to follow the law. And here the law is that if you prove a reasonable benchmark or set forth a reasonable yardstick.
Well, I guess the trial judge didn't feel that she did that.
Let me address that. We've got the three yardsticks were her experience. Then we have the national benchmark set by the MGMA that said you should have 98% to 99%. And then you have the previous experience of two of the same doctors in the previous practice, and it was a 99% rate. So they sit back and they took pot shots at that. And they said, well, you can't prove that your practice is exactly the same as the previous practice. You can't prove that your practice is the same as all the other practices that comprise the MGMA. And that's where the trial court was going here. The trial court accepted.
Are those not weight factors that go to the reasonableness of the expert's testimony? And as I read the record, it seems that the trial judge was struggling with finding that her testimony was reasonable when you consider all of the underlying variables that she alluded to.
Well,
not that it was not certainty, but that it was not reasonable when you consider each of those components, the differences in the type of practices, the delay in getting either Medicare or Medicaid number. It seems to me, and especially when you look at her or his order, that the focus was on reasonableness, not a lack of certainty, which would be an error.
I think the question is whether we have uncertainty here or speculation. We agree that if you find these benchmarks to be speculative, we lose on this issue. But I think what we have to do is step back and let's look at the Twyman case, because it's a perfect illustration, and I think it's exactly on all fours with this case, about how you distinguish between uncertainty and speculation. In that case, there was a breach, and as a result of a breach, a farmer didn't get a chance to plant a plot of English peas. And so the question was, what were the profits was that farmer going to make from that plot of English peas? And the Supreme Court reversed the trial court and said, that's speculative, because the Supreme Court said, you can look to see how other folks who planted English peas nearby did that year. But if you take
Was there a challenge in Twyman to the methodology? And that seems where the deficit was here. The trial court had problems with the methodology in part that this expert used.
But the trial court also rejected the damages as speculative. And what I think is interesting about Twyman is you could ask exactly the same questions in Twyman that were asked by the defendant here. You could say, well, farmer next door made $100 on his English pea crop, but maybe his soil was better than yours. Did you prove that your soil was the same as his? Maybe his drainage was better than yours. Did you prove that your drainage was the same as his? Maybe he's just a better farmer. Maybe he had a better tractor. Maybe he bought better seeds. You could always ask those kind of questions. And I think the teaching of the Supreme Court, from the Supreme Court in the Twyman v. Rao case, is just the fact that you can ask those sorts of questions doesn't render an uncertain damage to be speculative. And that's the line here. And so let's look at their excuses that they raised. Their first pot shot is, well, we didn't have the Medicare number. Well, whose fault was that? SSI started with this company 6 months before this practice opened. It takes 3 to 6 months to get a Medicare number. They took until 7 months after the practice opened to get that Medicare number. That was SSI's fault. That shouldn't fall on the corporation.
Mr. Brennick, in our standard of review on this issue, abuse of discretion?
If the trial court has misunderstood the law, which I think the trial court did, and conflated uncertainty with speculative, then no, we're talking about a de novo.
Well, it just seems like this is an issue of fact, and the trial court as finder of fact is listening to this testimony. It would seem to me it's an abuse of discretion, which means that in order for you to prevail on it, we have to find that no reasonable judge would have made this call. That's a pretty high hill to climb, isn't it?
I agree, unless I can convince you that the trial judge misunderstood uncertainty.
That's your time. I'm listening.
But that's exactly what the Supreme Court faced in the Twyman case. That you could have said exactly the same thing. You'll never be able to prove that your plot of land is exactly the same as the plot of land next door. Therefore, it's speculative. And the Supreme Court said, no, that doesn't make it speculative. It makes it uncertain. But the uncertainty is a defendant's problem, not the plaintiff's problem. It's the defendant that put the plaintiff in that position. So there are many cases in Florida that we've cited, including several from this court in the briefs, that talk about that very principle, and that if damages are merely uncertain because you can't prove absolute identity, that doesn't render those damages speculative. So I think that the trial judge simply misunderstood the burden here. So let's look at a couple of the other excuses, because I think these are critical in comparing this case to the Twyman case. They say that how do we know that this particular practice is the same as all the practices that are surveyed around the country by the MGMA?
But the judge also had the benefit of testimony that said there were unique things to this particular practice that made those collection goals of 99% not reasonably achievable here.
Exactly. Okay, so that's what they say. This is a new practice, and it may be a different practice mixed than the other practices nationally. My answer to that is, so what? You need, defendant, to explain to me why that mix of practices makes any difference in collection. We are not talking about rocket science here. We're talking about filling out a form correctly. We're talking about coding a form correctly. And if you do that, you get paid. And so I would agree, if they had come to the court and said, here's why the mix of practice makes a big difference in terms of your collection rate, then I think that we would have a classic factual situation here, and you'd have to defer to the trial judge. But that's what they didn't do. They talk about all these differences. It's a startup practice. It's a different mix of practice. But what they never did is they never filled in that blank to say, and here's why that makes a difference in your collections rate. I think absent that testimony, they have done nothing more than take uncertain damages and characterize them as speculative. For those reasons, we think that the trial judge erred as a matter of law and that those accounts receivable damages should be added back in.
You're at 10 minutes, and I know you've got another point you want to talk about. I think maybe what I'll do, since these cases are so complicated and there's so many issues, I'm going to give each side 3 more minutes. So if you want to go 3 minutes and do 13 and 10, and I'll let Mr. Elegant do the same.
All right, I appreciate that very much. So let me just briefly talk about the derivative damages. And we had 2 points that we made in our briefs relating to the derivative damages. And I think the first is pretty easy, which is that the trial court erred in giving a double credit to Dr. DeMozzi. The purpose of a derivative action is to make the corporation whole. So you determine what the damages were to the corporation, and the trial court here determined that the damages were $467,000. Now, obviously, we think that's too low, but let's accept that number for now. The trial judge on the front end awarded Dr. DeMozzi 1/3 credit and only required Dr. DeMozzi to pay $355,000, or $311,000, I think it was, back to the corporation, reducing the damages by 1/3. Now, I think the trial judge did that because he was a 1/3 shareholder, and she thought that he was going to be due a credit. But the problem with that is, and on the back end, after we had determined all the damages and the money was going to be distributed to the shareholders, she gave Dr. DeMozzi another 50% credit. So our simple argument that we make in the brief is that you're not entitled to a 1/3 credit up front and a 50% credit in the back. The second argument we make is a little more complicated, and I'll just touch on it very briefly, which is that we think that because Dr. DeMozzi was found to be the wrongdoer here, he should not share in the recovery.
That's now a troublesome concept. I mean, it is a troublesome concept, but I couldn't, in reading these briefs, I just didn't feel like you had a smoking gun to carry the day on it. So if you have one, it'd be your time to tell us.
What I have is, I concede that the general rule is that the wrongdoer gets their share. What I hang my hat on are a number of cases that's out of New York that suggest in a closed corporation context, I'm referring specifically to the Glenn case that talks about this, in a closed corporation context, that may not make sense because what it does is it doesn't provide enough of a disincentive for the member shareholders to treat their fellow shareholders fairly. And so the court suggests that perhaps in that context, it might be appropriate not to award any damages to the wrongdoer. I think that fits perfectly with typical Florida equitable principles, such as the doctrine of unclean hands, those who want equity, and a derivative action is an equitable action. If you want equity, you've got to have unclean hands. There was no clean hands here on behalf of Dr. DeMozzi. And then secondly, those who do equity.
Well, these are actions at law, though, aren't they?
Well, a derivative action has been characterized by the Florida courts as an equitable action.
You're at 13 minutes, Mr. Brannick, so you can use the rest of your time as you wish.
I appreciate that. So the Glenn case, if you take the Glenn case and the reasoning, which I think is very, very cogent in the Glenn case, you couple that with traditional Florida equitable principles, I think it's the building blocks that, and this case is the perfect case to write on now, but I think it provides the building blocks for the, I think, very common sense proposition that if you commit a wrong, you shouldn't share in the proceeds from that wrong.
Let's assume we agree with you that the methodology employed by the trial court was incorrect. All of the monies should have been paid to the corporation. You reverse it. There are still only 2 shareholders.
Right.
So your client would get 1/3 or 1/2?
Our first argument is that our client would get it all. The second argument would that would
if
be
we find there are equitable facts if you, that would support giving him the whole pot.
Right. The equitable argument that I just made, that you want to ensure that there's a disincentive for shareholders to treat their fellow shareholders like Dr. DeMozzi treated his fellow shareholders here.
So how would you factor in the circumstances that are unique to this case, that this corporation is basically defunct?
Well, I think that makes it easier. So the question is, where does the money go? And I think there are strong equitable principles that I've just argued that say that the money should go to the remaining shareholder who did not participate in the wrong. That's Dr. Kondupalli. Alternatively, 50-50, or third, two-thirds to Dr. Kondupalli, because, of course, Dr. Grossbart has relinquished his one-third share and the remaining third. What we suggest is that the court was wrong just to throw up her hands and divide it 50-50. It should go back for a full accounting so we can make those arguments to the trial court and also make arguments related to any expenses that Dr. Kondupalli may have suffered as a result of bringing this action. If I may, I'll reserve the rest of my time.
All right. You've got 8 minutes left total.
Good morning. May it please the court. I'm Tom Elegant with Ewell and Elegant here with my partner Amy Ferrier and trial counsel, co-counsel on the appeal, Steve Hutton. I'm going to start, if I may, with the cross appeal, because if you agree with us on the cross appeal, we don't have to fool with the damage stuff. Okay, so that's an added bonus.
How did you want to divide your time up, Mr. Elegant?
Oh, I'd like to. I'll take 5 minutes for rebuttal, and I have more.
All right. So thank you.
Thank you. If I could, I'm old school. I'll give Mr. Brand a copy of this. I'd like to give the court the release language. I'm sure you have on your computers, but I see that we refer to it here, and I want to go through it because I do think our position is the trial court did err in the two grounds on which she found that this release did not apply. The first ground, she argued, well, this was a release of claims by the doctors. GCD didn't release the claims. Well, let's put this in context. GCD had stopped doing business by January of 2009. Stopped doing business. This release is signed in September of 2009. So by that time, there's no company anymore. It's not in business. There are three shareholders. The three shareholders signed this agreement. They are all there is that's functioning. Okay? So the court does note in her one of her judgments that the company was reincorporated in 2010, and she says she assumes to bring this suit. But in 2009, when this is signed, GCD doesn't even exist as a functioning entity. And I would suggest to you that when you look at the context of the wording here, the three doctors discharged the other party in the first line, and then you go to liability in the fourth line down, liability for any and all claims, and then it goes and lists a whole bunch of things, contracts, torts. Keep on going. Whether the damages has yet resulted in any way, directly or indirectly, arising out of the relationship as a member, manager, employee of the company. Okay, these, and one more thing I guess I should have said when looking at the timeline. GCD's amended complaint that Dr. Kondupalli brought as a derivative action, it pleads that in the winter of 2008, they discovered that Demasi had been misleading. Dr. Demasi had been misleading. We don't agree with that, but that's what they pled. So they're pleading, winter of 2008, we know. January of 2009, we're out of business. September of 2009, we sign a release. It says everything's released, except, and I'll come to the exception later, but the first error the trial judge was made was saying, well, you didn't have the corporation sign it. The corporation wasn't even functioning then. When the three doctors sign a release that says, I'm releasing everything directly.
Well, what's the significance of the fact that the company was not functioning? I mean, it's still an entity. It still has whatever rights and obligations it had. Why is it so important that it wasn't conducting business?
I think because when people signed this release, they assumed they were getting a complete release of everything related to the company. The three doctors, and they do. I mean, they release each other from everything under it. So I think the question becomes, is this broad language that covers all these things, is that enough? Or does that prevent Kondupalli from bringing a derivative suit? What is a derivative suit? They say in their brief, well, Kondupalli, the shareholder, steps into the shoes of the corporation. That's right. He's using the corporation indirectly to go after money for himself. That is using it indirectly, which is exactly what he released, indirectly. Said he would not, he said, I'm releasing you from all claims directly or indirectly. And you come on down and says, with regard to the company. Okay, now, the second exception, or the second ground on which the trial court relied, you come down to the, notwithstanding the foregoing, this release of liability no way contemplates the release of any potential claims with respect to medical malpractice, criminal or other misconduct, or violation to comply with laws involving Medicare and so forth, the very bottom, the last paragraph. That was the second ground on which the court said, well, this is criminal or other misconduct. But you have to look at that whole sentence, and you have to look at it in the context of the release. First off, it says, in no way contemplates the release of any potential claims. Potential meaning, we don't know about it yet. It may still be out there. They've pled in 2008. We knew about these claims. We knew. And then in September 2009, you signed something. You say, well, I'm giving up everything except potential claims. So they knew about it. They released these claims. Then let's look at the nature of those. Up above, in the release, before the notwithstanding, is talking about everything, settlement agreement, releases everything, from the operating agreement, rights and responsibilities set forth in the operating agreement, employment agreement, and so forth. In other words, the agreements between these people. That's what they're releasing. Then it says notwithstanding, and you look at what's notwithstanding. It are things that a third party would do. A third party would bring a malpractice claim. Even then, they had to specifically list malpractice because they've already released torts up above. Fraud is a tort. They've released fraud up above. They don't put fraud down here, though. All these claims, criminal or other misconduct, that's going to be brought by some other party. You have to read the other misconduct in context of the criminal. If you read it the way they want to, they say, well, this is all misconduct. That's what they convinced the trial judge of. Well, goodness, you don't need a release to release things that aren't misconduct. I mean, that's what the whole release is about. Everything that's being released is misconduct of some sort. So to say, well, it encompasses everything, that reads that last paragraph completely out of the release. That, or it reads basically everything up above out. I mean, it means nothing if you read it the way they do. So you have to read it in the context. They are releasing for themselves, including anything they could do indirectly, which is through GCD, and they're releasing all these claims, except these claims a third party can bring. Sure, if the PA gets sued for malpractice by some third party, and that hasn't happened, sure, there's an exception for that. That makes sense. As we pointed out, there are statutes, for example, sexual misconduct by a doctor. Some claims made against the company by some third person or against one of the doctors saying, hey, you shouldn't let him do this, you know, that's not being released. They have that claim among themselves.
So does the record tell us who the drafter of this was?
I don't think so.
We just don't know.
I don't know. Pardon?
Prior.
Yeah, there was probably, I think it was probably, anybody in this room.
No.
Okay.
And you understand more. I don't think the record. Because this is a, misconduct. I don't really know what that means. I don't think anybody in this room knows really what that means. Well, so I want to know who I should construe this document against, if anybody.
Judge, I would say.
I understand that, but that's not the point.
Right. No, I know. And of course, the construe against the drafter is one method of resolving how you interpret things, but I think we can interpret.
It's the only one I got on the table right now.
Well, actually, Your Honor, I think you can. I think the other rules of construction are: you read the specific, you read the document as a whole. If you read misconduct to mean everything, like they want to, that makes this whole release ridiculous.
Like the judge did below, the trial judge obviously did too. Right?
She was just wrong.
I understand that's your position.
and this is, and everybody agrees, this is a question of law. Construing this is a question of law. So, all right, let me move on because. The second point I want to discuss on the cross appeal is the fraud issue. And you might say, well, wait a minute, they got the same damages under the contract or under the statutory claim, and you got the same damage under the fraud. Why do we care about the fraud claim? Why am I singling that out? And I'll tell you. I'm singling that out because it could be important to dischargeability issues in bankruptcy. Because this is not why Dr. DeMasi is in bankruptcy. He has a lot of other issues, or some other issues dealing with properties, with the market downturn and so forth. But if this were not dischargeable, it would hamper his ability to get back going again. So this is very important to him. Even if you were to affirm on everything else and affirm the damages and so forth, to say, look, there wasn't fraud here. And let me go and explain why we say there wasn't fraud. That's in part page 64 of our initial brief. This court has said repeatedly that you have to have different damages for fraud. And I just said before, it's the same damages. It is. There was no distinction in the judgment saying, well, I'm giving you so much for fraud, so much for contracts. It's the same damages, the exact same. This court said in John Brown, we've cited the case, 1988, that you have no fraud claim if the damages merely duplicate the contract claim. And that holding predates the economic loss rule. It is not they try to say, oh, well, you got some economic loss. That economic loss has got nothing to do with this. For a fraud claim, you need distinct, different damages. The John Brown case cited the Rolls case. Fraud compensatory damages must be distinct from contract damages. Then this court in Huey says, quote, it is true a fraud claim may not be pursued if its damages merely duplicate the damages recoverable for breach of related contract. And that cites John Brown, and that's during the era when we have economic loss rule. The case they cite, they say, well, the HTP case says you can have fraudulent inducement and breach. Well, that's not the point. you can have both. And in the, as the HTP case talks about, you can sue for damages for the fraud that you were induced into a contract, and then you can sue for separate damages for the breach of the contract. That doesn't go to the damages at all. This court in John Brown and Huey has made very clear, you need to come out and say, here's our separate fraud damages. Here's something distinct about it. They didn't do it here. There's no dispute about that. So at a minimum, the fraud damage part should be set aside. If there are no other questions on that, I will, or any other aspect of our cross appeal, I will turn back and now do the damages part of the initial appeal. And let me get to my page on that. Okay. On the first part.
Well, can I ask you a question on the first part? As long as we're moved off.
Yes.
You know, and it looks like you're trying to get started.
Let's get started here. Go ahead.
The derivative action that is brought is where the shareholder is a wrongdoer. It's wrong to let him recover. I mean, that is a compelling argument. Mr. Brannick's made a very good argument that a derivative action is in the nature of equity. And in order to get equity, you must do equity. You want to respond to that?
Yes, Your Honor. Glad to. That's the second part. They're not seeking equity. They're seeking punishment. Their brief, they're a little more straightforward about that. On page 46 of the reply brief, he admits he's seeking a punitive award. He calls it deterrence, but that's what it is. A deterrence award is a punitive award. There is not a single Florida case that they cite that stands for the proposition they argue. There's not a single case out of state. They say, well, there's some language in the New York cases. The New York cases say, well, this may seem kind of unfair, but it's the law. They haven't got any cases that go their way. And if you were
but
going
maybe
to...
maybe there ought to be a case.
Well, and maybe there ought to be, but not here, Judge, and here's why. The rationale behind those cases, when you look at it, and you didn't hear this today, but if you look in the briefs, you will see them saying, you'll say, well, a member of the company, in the closed company, shouldn't be able, when he's paying back the company, he shouldn't be able to share in the ill-gotten gains. That's the words they use, ill-gotten gains. And the one case there was one case where the person went out and they made gazillions of dollars, you know, sold the thing, you know, at a loss, and then when they get caught and they put the money back in, well, they get to keep some of it. Maybe you want to deter somebody from cheating the company and making a whole bunch of money off it and pocketing it. Ill-gotten gains. There are no ill-gotten gains here. There are nothing but losses in this case. Nothing but losses. The $605,000 is the loss to the company. There is no ill-gotten gain to split up. Dr. DeMasi's not getting any money. He's paying money, only paying money. He is not getting anything out of money going to the company.
Isn't it also important that the money come back into the corporation so that the corporation, you know, Scott may have tax obligations, may have other creditors, and you know, if it's properly worked, I mean, nobody may get anything. The creditors get money.
And Your Honor, and the trial judge recognized that and said, look, we're 4 years past when this company dissolved in 2009. It was just started again in 2010 to bring the suit. You know, I would assume anything has been done that would be done to take care of this. But you know what? Let's have an accounting. If something's owed, bring it to me and show me. Was essentially what she said, because when Dr. Condopoli said, I want all the money, she said, whoa, I'm troubled by that. That's overreaching. I'm troubled by that. There's no reason you should get all the money. There were no ill-gotten gains, as I said. So she was troubled by that. She said, look, we can have an accounting. Bring, she left it open that they might be able to. There's nothing that I'm aware of in the record where they came in and said, oh, Judge, look, here's a creditor that owes some money. So we got to put some money back into the company. That's not what they wanted. As you heard this morning, he wants it all. He didn't say anything about, I want it so I can pay a creditor. He wants it all. There's no case in the country, and I would respectfully submit, in the context of a no ill-gotten gain situation, only losses, there's no reason to reach out and create some new law, to go where no court has ever gone before, if you will. She was aware of that, and she said, you know, show me where you need to do something. I'll require an accounting. they didn't put an accounting in, because there are no creditors. At least none that our record reflects, and we're 4 years down the road at that point from that. Okay. Have I answered your question that? Okay, let me go now to the accounting part of this case, if you will. Because as the saying goes, they made this a lot more complicated than it really is, okay? There was a $605,000 loss the way the judge calculated, okay? And that is, with all due respect, too much. As we point out later in our brief, they got a judgment for $190,000 for fees paid to SSI. There were only $35,000 paid. So it's $160,000 too much right there. But, and that's one of our more minor points in the brief. But as I say, we'd like to just have no fraud, and you can give them all those damages, because then we'll it will not impact the big picture. But the no fraud finding is important. But getting back to the dollars, as we point out, and they want to say, well, it's a third, it's a half, and it's confusing. Yeah, they made it very confusing. And the judge did take a little bit different approach to it. But here is the way the math really works. And I think they essentially concede that, because in our brief, we said, look, the loss was about $615,000. If you look at the amount lost and then the prejudgment interest, $615,000. And at page 48 of their reply brief, which, of course, the answer brief to ours, that's why nobody would have 48 pages of reply brief, of course. Page 48 of their reply brief, they agree $615,000 is a number. $615,000, three doctors, $205,000 each. Pretty simple. Pretty simple. Dr. Grossbard said, I'm out. I don't want to have anything to do with this suit. He refused to assign his share to Kondapalli, so that's just in the wind. Kondapalli gets paid his 205, or gets a judgment for his 205. There's no point in putting 205 into the company that would just go back to DeMasi. So 205 are the damages. That's the correct number based on what the court concluded there. If you agree with the 467 plus prejudgment interest. Now, were there errors in what the court did to calculate the 467? We say, yeah, it's too much, as I just said a moment ago. What about their point? They're saying, well, she didn't like the to say that their expert was called into question is being pretty kind. Their expert was impeached and drilled on cross-examination. She had to admit she had a $300-something thousand error in her numbers. If that's not enough to already say, well, it's looking a little shaky here, that would certainly get you puzzled about that. You know, this is supposed to be an expert, and a $300,000 error comes out on cross-exam. She only looked at 1 year of this other business, 1 year, 2005, the height of the bubble, down in Florida and in there. By the time this company gets going, the new four-person, different entity gets going, it's 2007. Florida enters a depression in March of 2007. Housing market collapses in 2006. Florida hits a depression in March 2007. The rest of the country comes later in 2007.
Yeah, but do we have any evidence in our record to suggest the economy has anything to do with this practice? Or are we just all guessing that? Because we, as we know, not everybody was affected in the same ways. So,
right. I'm just saying, it's a factor out there for her to... that she's entitled to consider. There are differences in the business, as she noted. The benchmark is not applicable to startups. Startups are treated differently. If you look at the cases we cite at page 31, 32 of our answer brief, there's case law that says, yeah, you look at startups differently. Here's, I think, the biggest fallacy they have, or the biggest problem they have to overcome, is that, as we pointed out in our answer brief, their accountant or expert, whatever she was, failed to account for this. She looked at the time frame of just a particular time while SSI was there. SSI, then they terminate SSI. Money comes in after that. She makes no evaluation how much money. So everything that didn't was billed and didn't come in while SSI is there is a loss. What happens if 90% of that money comes in after they leave, or 80%, or 95%? We don't know, because she didn't do that. And they have, unless I missed it, they have no response to that in their reply brief. None. So there are a whole bunch of problems with the way their expert did the math. The Twyman case does not save them. And here's why. In fact, the Twyman case shows what's wrong with what they did. In Twyman, as one of the questions from the panel indicated, Twyman case, they go through, if you look at the last page of the case, they go through, and the trier of fact there, the trial court is actually like a master and then a chancellor, but I guess the case is from 1936, so I guess 80 years ago or whatever, things were a little different. But anyway, they go through in the Twyman case, and they say, basically, when I talk about the field was, you know, seed pods were available. There were no weather conditions that would have seriously injured a crop. The muck land of the same general quality and character in the vicinity was so much per acre. Here, the trial judge made the factual findings and said, yeah, A is like B. They're the same. But, you know, I think that's still speculative. I'm not going to do it. That's not what happened here. Here, the judge said, there's lots of things that are different. You haven't accounted for. You haven't accounted for the different practice. You've used 1 year. You haven't used a startup. You haven't accounted for monies that were collected later. There's a bunch of factual differences here. So the judge, getting back to your point, Judge Morris, the judge is entitled to, and Judge Crenshaw's point, judge is entitled to say, I'm the weigher of the evidence. You've got a bunch of problems. They've been brought out on cross-exam. We don't have to bring in new evidence. When the cross-exam destroys the witness, you don't need to come pile on and bring your own expert in.
Mr. Allegate, if you want to save any time for rebuttal, you've got about 4 minutes left.
Okay, unless there are any further questions on that, I will...
On the other hand, it sort of goes without saying, and it's somewhat intuitive, any business that can't collect its bills are going to suffer damages, and if you've hired somebody to collect them and they're not, you've been harmed.
And they were given an award of $605,000 here, Your Honor. And the question is, is that too much or too little? And that's a fact call for the judge. Thank you.
Mr. Brannick, you've got a total of 10 minutes left, sir.
All right. Thank you, Judge. Let me address Mr. Elligott's arguments in the order he raised. I'd first like to look at the release. And there are two points that I'd like to make relating to the release. The first is a pretty obvious one, which is that the corporation didn't release anyone. And the law of Florida is clear. You apply the language of a release as written. If the parties had wished to release any cause of action that the corporation may have had, they certainly could have put that language in the release. They didn't. I think that's number one. Number two.
What are we to make of directly or indirectly then? Do we just read that out of the release or?
This is a cause of action that's brought on behalf of the corporation. Anyone could have brought this cause of action, including a successor who wasn't even part of this particular release document here. If the corporation, for example, had been sold down the road, someone had discovered these wrongs and had brought this cause of action. So this isn't an indirect claim on behalf of Dr. Khandapalli. Khandapalli is suing on behalf of the corporation, but then any of the shareholders of the corporation, past or present or future, will benefit in that award. So I don't think it's an indirect benefit.
Couldn't you see it as sort of a gotcha by Dr. Khandapalli? I'm not saying that it is. I'm just saying that's maybe one way of looking at it.
Well, another way of looking at it is if you'd wanted to release the corporation, you could have released the corporation. And, you know, we can't second guess what the parties agreed to after the fact. The language is clear, and you have to enforce it as written. But I think there's an even easier way to resolve this, which is the criminal or other misconduct. Now, misconduct doesn't mean everything. You know, when people operate a corporation, you can always second guess each other's mistakes. Maybe people were negligent in the operation of a corporation. But negligence or making mistakes is very different from intentionally engaging in misconduct, which is what the trial judge found here. Intentional misconduct, fraud, I think she calls it a disturbing pattern of misconduct. So
one of the things I have trouble with, though, on that issue is the agreement that they had, Section 6.9, where it says, you know, we're all going to have these outside interests, and if we do have these out, you know, to me the most egregious misconduct is that he was a principal and an owner in SSI and didn't tell anybody. And everything sort of flowed from that.
Right.
But the agreement they had among themselves says you can do that. I can have these. I can have these other deals, and I don't really have to tell you about it.
Well, it doesn't say you don't have to tell them.
Well, that's true. That's a good point. It doesn't say that. So maybe disclosure is left silent in that agreement.
Exactly. If Dr. DeMozzi had disclosed to his partners, and by the way, when I'm talking about SSI, take that with a grain of salt because I've got a huge financial interest in their success. I think that would be a very different case. The problem here is that he had that interest and he hid it from his partners, and when his partners started to uncover evidence relating to that connection, he vehemently denied it. I think the trial judge is very solid on the liability ruling. So then getting back to the release, criminal or other misconduct. Well, what does misconduct mean? I think the easy dividing line for misconduct is it's the difference between engaging in negligence or making mistakes and engaging in intentional wrongs. I think by saying criminal and other misconduct, what the parties were saying is that, you know, you're not gonna be able to sue for negligence, you're not gonna be able to second guess my business judgment, but if you catch me having done something intentionally wrong, that's not part of the release. I think that's the most reasonable way to read that language. On the fraud issue, I think that's been resolved by the Tierra condominium case that has eliminated the economic loss rule except in product liability actions. The Tierra case makes clear. It's also talking about those cases where you have tort and contract claims that overlap. The question is, did you prove a tort? And if you proved a tort, then you can sue for fraud. And it doesn't matter whether the damages are the same. The Rolls case, the John Brown case, those are just early primitive economic loss rule cases, cases struggling with the dividing line between tort and contract. And the Supreme Court in Tierra cases said, you don't need to struggle anymore. There's no artificial divide between the two. You prove your cause of action, you win. It's as simple as that. On the derivative action argument, Mr. Elegant made a big distinction between ill-gotten gains and mere losses, as if, you know, what's the problem about losses? But that takes us right back to the discussion in that Glenn case in the state in New York. If you can take action that causes loss to your fellow shareholders, let's take an extreme example because I think it helps illustrate the point. You're a 90% majority shareholder and you've got 10% minority shareholders. You've got a very, if you know that if you get caught, all you're going to do is have to pay that 10%, that's a very minor disincentive to committing the wrong. And so what the Glenn case says is maybe in the closed corporation context, that shouldn't be the rule. Now, I agree, there aren't any cases reaching that holding yet, but I think this is the case. And it is the case because, one, we are talking about fraud. We're talking about intentional misconduct here. And I really like the language that Judge Casanueva used in his concurring opinion in that Mortalite case that we cited in the brief, which is sometimes you have a choice. And if the choice is between rewarding the wrongdoer or perhaps giving what might be characterized as a windfall to the other side, well, if my choice is between the wrongdoer and the side that was wronged, I think the law chooses the side that was wronged. That's the simple point that we make here, and I think that's why this might be the appropriate case to follow that language in the Glenn case. On the numbers, Mr. Elegant has this very deceptive and very simple accounting, $615,000 worth of damages. Dr. Condopoli is a one-third shareholder. He gets one-third, that's 205. What he's leaving out of that equation is that means that Dr. DeMasi, the wrongdoer, is getting 410. Think about how this would normally work. Let's say the damages are $605,000. You take that $605,000 and you put it into the corporation. The corporation then generally would make the decision as to how that money would be distributed. Under Mr. Elegant's example, what he's suggesting is that $205,000 would go to Dr. Condopoli. Well, where does the other $410,000 go?
But the problem is these are corporate losses. And if there are corporate losses that are recovered, irrespective of where they're gotten from, they're distributed to the shareholders according to their interests. That's fundamental. And even if the wrongdoer gets it, whatever the other shareholders got truly made them whole.
But under his example, Dr. Condopoli would get $205,000. Dr. DeMasi would get $410,000, even though Dr. DeMasi is also a one-third shareholder. So if you're going to use his example, you've got to at least make it 50-50. You can't make it one-third to Dr. Condopoli, two-thirds to Dr. DeMasi. But I think the best way to go about it is the way that we went about it very carefully in our brief, which is it's a two-step process. Step one, determine the amount of damages. And you have to resolve all the legal issues we've talked about today, but once you decide that, that flows into the corporation. Then number two, applying these equitable principles, how is that money distributed? And I think that's the roadmap that you use. And if you use that roadmap, you're not going to come up with $205,000. There's no way you can come up with that, because that essentially gives Dr. DeMozzi twice what he's entitled to. Then, getting back to where I started, which was the accounts receivable, the expert made one serious mistake, but it was an easy mistake. She just thought that the practice started on July 1st, 2000, in, I forget the year now, 2006, as opposed to January 1st, 2007. That was an easily correctable date. As soon as it was pointed out to her, she said, oh, you're right. There was a factual mistake there. You just lop off that $300,000 worth of damages. That fixed that problem. So then they complained, well, they only looked at 1 year. Well, Twyman only looked at 1 year. And there was no evidence in this case as to why that 1 year was not representative. Mr. Elgin says, well, it's the height of the bubble. But this brings me back to the theme I was trying to emphasize in my initial presentation. Why in the world does that make any difference? We're not talking about the success or failure of the business in its operations. We're talking about the simple process of collecting the bills. Whether or not the economy is great or whether or not the economy is lousy, all you have to do to collect those bills is fill out the form the right way, cross your T's, dot your I's, and if you do that, you're going to get a 98% to 99% rate, regardless of the economy, because we're not collecting bills from payers who are going belly up. We're collecting bills from the federal government and from the great big insurance companies. So that's the missing piece of their argument. Why do all of these excuses that they raise make any difference in connection with the collection rate? It's a starter. Okay, so what? It's the same form. You fill out the form, you cross the T's, you dot the I's, you get your money. It's a different practice. Again, so what? You fill out the form, you cross the T's, you dot the I's, and you get your money. Again, that's what's missing in their argument. If they couple that argument with an argument as to why it would make a difference in collections, I would agree with them. But they didn't, and that's why we disagree. So for all those reasons, we think that this court should reverse on the damage award that affirm on liability.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Brannick. Mr. Elligott, you have 4 minutes left for rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. With regard to the release, Dr. Conopoli's position is anyone could have brought it. Anyone could have brought a suit for the corporation, the three shareholder corporation. But anyone didn't. The person who brought it promised that he was releasing claims and would not directly or indirectly come after Dr. DeMozzi or Dr. Grossbard for any of these other things. It wasn't somebody else. It was him. It was the guy who signed it and said, I won't do it directly or indirectly, and the court let him get away with it. And that was wrong. Unless there are any further questions, we would ask that you reverse on the release, at a minimum reverse on the fraud, because nothing has, the economic loss rule is a red herring here. Even you look at Judge Perianti's concurring opinion there, and she says, you still got to prove the elements of fraud, and fraud requires distinct damages, as this court has repeatedly said. So we would ask that you reverse on both those grounds. Thank you.
All right, thank you both, gentlemen. It's very interesting and well argued on both sides. You want to do one more?
Yeah, let's do one more. Yeah.
All right. And then. All right. This is right. Right.